Hello, my name is Kelechi Amadi. I am a photographer and a publisher of many a magazine, Style Mania magazine, and you are watching Pulse TV. Well, it depends on what I'm trying to do. For me, every photograph is a story being told, you know? And if I set out, you know, to tell a particular story, then that will inform, you know, the angle I want to go in, you know? Like, a good example is maybe you have a brief from a client and you're listening to that brief. But then sometimes we're just going with the flow, you know? I mean, we have a sketchy idea of what we want to achieve and we get on location and we then let the location speak to us, you know? So it's a combination of design and accident. You design things and then life comes in between and then you design around the accident. For me, that is the ultimate environment for originality because you don't want to plan too much. Most times when you plan too much, you end up repeating what you've done before. Oh well, you know, photography itself is a child of technology. I mean, you wouldn't be making photographs if this guy didn't accidentally discover that, you know, silver halides would maintain an image and all that, you know. So right from the beginning of photography, it's been based on technology. And in recent times, technology has moved at an exponential, like, speed. And every time something changes in photography, a major change comes, a lot of people fall by the wayside. Those who couldn't adapt to change and adapt to change, they will complain about the good old days, you know, and those who can't understand how it works. What has happened with digital photography is that it's been made very available because the average phone has like a 10 megapixel camera on it, and they've been improving on this. You know, some of them are shooting 4K, you know, video now. And what that does is that it puts this strong photographic equipment in the hands of the ordinary person. So more people are discovering that maybe photography is what they really want to do because their phone already is giving them enough practice. Yeah, but you don't have a problem. Really, if you're talking about Photoshop, even the days of film, we used to manipulate images in the dark room. So right from the beginning of time, photography in itself is a two-dimensional, you know, kind of rendition. That in itself is already not realistic. Life is three-dimensional. You understand? You know, when you make a picture black and white, you've taken out color. That is not realistic. So a lot of times, you know, when people start complaining about how far you've gone with manipulating the image, it all depends. Those who are doing reportage, even when they do that, they have to choose the right time to click and the right angle to click from. That in itself is subjective. You understand? So, in terms of what digital has done, what it has done is to put a good camera in everybody's hands. Therefore, you now find out who the real photographers are. Because you start discovering the photographic eye. So people are beginning to appreciate photography more now than they used to appreciate before. Because they've tried it and they can find how difficult it is to make strong images over and over and over again. It goes beyond the intelligence of your camera. Sometimes you can't really put your hand on it, you know. I can only tell you about my intention. Yes, I strive to make timeless images that will stand the test of time, visual impact. I'm also interested in creating beauty. I'm very, very, you know, from my painting days, aesthetics and color and balance and things like that play a very strong role, you know, that great influences on my photographs. People look at my work and they say they can always tell, you know, but I don't know. You know, and you know, for me, it's I don't know. It's difficult, really, because sometimes I'm playing with contrast, sometimes I'm playing with harmony, sometimes it's the story, you know, that we're telling that is compelling, you understand. Sometimes it's a contrast, you know, you get inspiration from other places away from the visual. You know, you're talking about now culture, you're talking about literature, sometimes it's engineering, it's architecture, you know, a lot of factors that come in. You know, for me, to make an original thing, is when you take two unrelated objects and you place them together. I don't believe there is anything that is completely original. Everything is a remix. You know, so you open your mind, you know, and adapt and adopt things that you see. And it's when it comes together and then you create something new and people look at it and say, oh, I've never seen this before. You know, it's like when you take a harp, you know, and place it flat and then incorporate the keyboard of a typewriter, you've got a piano, which is a completely original idea, right? But if you look closely, you find that it's a remix of a harp and a piano. Well, you know, the thing about money is that it's a very funny thing, especially coming from the point of art. You know, art demands that you express yourself, that you be original, which in itself can be the antithesis of a business model. Business model says, find out what the people want, create it, and give it to them. That can hardly be original, if you get what I mean. So it seems as if that they are cross purposes. But what I find is that if you do good work that serves a purpose, you understand, that satisfies a need, money will follow. And if you hone your craft to the point where you become the best, then you will attract the highest paying clients. Because those who are looking the best, are looking for the best, are willing to pay the highest. You understand? So it's a very funny thing. You know, first you have to start with trying to be the absolute best that you can. Because what then happens? Some people say, oh, let us find the one that is selling and let us do that. Then we'll make money. But when you do that, you betray this kind of mediocrity and this kind of, how do I put it? It's always you're replicating what has been done before. Then people see it as a copy of the original. But when your goal is to make something great that will satisfy you, the urge to create, invariably people start to see how unique your work is, and then the money then follows. So I always tell young people, first believe in yourself, because that's the problem. People don't believe in themselves enough to trust their gut instincts to say, you see, this is what I want to do and this is how I want to do it. I don't really care if anybody wants to buy it. It's my own way. And when you do that and you stick to it long enough and you do it well enough, people start to see how you stand out from the crowd. You know, I would tell people, art in itself is not so much about problem solving. It's about creating problems. So if you create a problem that nobody has found a solution to, and then you solve it, you become the only one with the solution to that problem. You get what I mean? Like, you know, for instance, you know, when they brought the iPad and, you know, Steve Jobs was like, you know, the iPad becomes what you make it. A lot of times people didn't know what the iPad was until they bought one. But people didn't say, oh, we want an iPad before he started making them. You get what I mean? That's a typical example of how art works, you know? So for me, it was me having fun and trying to enjoy myself creating the kind of images that excite me, and I found out that invariably some other people share in those sentiments with the images that I created, and I found out that it does have some value that it gives to the audience. You know, it's either it's got a high aesthetic level, or it's got visual impact, or it's got cultural impact. You know, after a while, people started looking at the way I told my own stories, and they want to pay me to help them tell their stories with my style. Of course, Painting is also a visual art, and you're also sort of grappling with a two-dimensional, surface, and to create an illusion of three-dimensionality sometimes. You know, you have a two-dimensional space and you're creating the illusion of depth. In photography, we're always also trying to do that. You're trying to create balance. For painting, it's something that sometimes you have to create from the scratch originally. But also in photography, you can also create a scenario by staging it. You understand? You know, and then it becomes painting with light, not with oil color. Incidentally, photography means painting with light, photo and graphy, you know? Yeah. It's interesting, you know, for me, I believe that it's all a journey, you know, life itself is a journey. There is no arrival. There may be milestones, you understand. So for me, you know, every new project is as exciting as the next, you know. Maybe some will get more accolades than others, you know. Maybe you do a lot of work and get one masterpiece, if you get what I mean. That masterpiece might even not be your favorite, if you get what I mean, you know. So it's, I don't know, it's difficult to pinpoint which one image, you know, does that. Earlier in my career, I would say, oh, you know, this, when I came to shoot this person, or when I did that ad campaign, but these days it's become my daily routine. Those things that earlier in my career, I would be, you know, gasping and getting excited has become my daily routine. So now, sometimes it's not shooting a very famous person, it's probably just discovering something on the street, or some random person can be more exciting to me, you know, than that. Yes. Well, I mean, you know, we all face the same challenges, you know, infrastructural challenges, you know, you try grappling with light, you're grappling with, you know, but one of the major challenges at the earlier stages of my career was dealing with extremely ignorant clients, you know, people who did not really appreciate the importance of imagery. So you're on a negotiating table with a client, and you know at the back of your mind that you're not going to close this deal. This will end with some kind of education of the client because he does not understand. So those years I spent educating people. And I look at the client and I say, you know, 2 years down the line, you'll find out that, you know, the price I was offering you is 5 naira compared to what you would spend having mediocre images. And like 2 years down the line, they come back. And, you know, they pay what you're asking for because, you know, the value that you bring to their brand, you know, makes sense. Well, I've always been obsessed, you know, with looking at those pictures in glossy magazines. You know, fashion photography for me is a beautiful synergy, you know, between fine art photography and commercial photography, because at the end of the day, you are really trying to sell clothes. But then it provides you that environment where you can express yourself and it's tolerated. You know, I can do a fashion shoot now, and with that fashion shoot, I'm really talking about, you know, how we don't have enough light, you know, so it can have layers. You understand? You can do a fashion shoot that talks about corruption, but yet you're selling couture outfits. You understand what I mean? And that's what I love about, you know, fashion editorials. And so when, I think it was the first magazine that came to Nigeria that was offering fashion editorials on their pages was True Love magazine, and they were looking for a photographer that had a portfolio. Luckily for me, I had been making all these fashion shoots that nobody sent me, you know, to go and make. So I had a portfolio, and they looked at it and they were impressed. And that was how I started my first commercially viable fashion, you know, editorial shoots. But eventually, True Love sort of, you know, left Nigeria, and then we had Next, which was like a weekend pullout. You know, they were doing editorials every weekend. I thought that was exciting. And then again, they got defunct again and closed. So there I was, a fashion photographer with no fashion magazine. You know, I mean, it's like, you know, it's like, how do I put it? You know, a fish out of water. And I decided that, you know what? You know, if I'm having this problem, then a lot of people will have the same problem. So I decided to start Mania. And the goal was to be able to tell the Nigerian story through fashion by Nigerians, but with international quality. 6 years down the line, I think we've achieved that. Well, I mean, there are a lot of lessons. I mean, I'm trying to big one. I mean, first of all, you just have to know that everything is in a flux. You know, from one to the other, you never stop. And so it's about, first of all, taking the bull by the horn and taking care of fear. So what I've been able to achieve with Mania is understanding that when you say something is going to happen, just believe it. It will happen. We've been able to make so many impossibilities with Mania that it's given me the confidence that all you need to do is to imagine stuff and the universe will conspire to make it happen. Well, I mean, there are some of the designers that have been around since the beginning of my career as a photographer. I have great respect for people like Jola Sego, Tiffany Amber, you know, Joe Bailisa and the rest of them. But there are a lot of very, very talented young designers these days. There seems to be an explosion of talent, you know, and, you know, the AG Rose and the rest of them. And it's beautiful, really. I mean, I can see this vibrant, you know, variety of talent that is coming out and blossoming. And all we can pray for is for them to get organized enough to have a proper industry and start making some serious money. You get what I mean? I mean, let them put clothes on the back of Nigerians, period, you know? What do you mean by overpriced? You know, I mean, if the price of a thing is based on your pocket. So what one somebody would say is overpriced is super terribly cheap to somebody else. So I guess it depends on who you're talking about. And I also think they are referring to mass produced outfits and they're comparing them to other design outfits in Europe and United States that have this huge industry where they can make a million trousers and they are reaping the gains of scale. You understand? Our designers haven't gotten to that level. So they're making these handmade clothes. You want to get your suit made handmade, then go to London or any of those places and then try to compare the price with the one of Nigeria, even though they're cheap. You understand? And I forgot to mention Moody. That's one of the top Nigerian designers that, well, I wear a lot of his stuff over the years. Amazing. He's one of the few that has been able to also cross that threshold where you have your own distribution, you know, all over Africa. Amazing. Well, you do need infrastructure, and some of that infrastructure requires huge investment. You see, we're talking about manufacturing here, not just having a few tailors at the back of your shop. You know, I mean, we also need to look at the textile industry. I mean, if you are spending dollars bringing all these textiles from abroad, you know, you have to. Nigeria is not the only place where people are facing this challenge. They are facing in the UK because they are trying to compete with China, you know, or Malaysia and some of these places where labor is very, very cheap, but the quality is also very high. You see, one thing we have here is that labor is cheap also. But what we have is the skill and the investment, the share investment, you know. If you have manufacturing houses where people could go to and say, look at my design, you know, make me 100,000 of this, you know, and then, of course, when you finish making the outfits, how about distribution? That's another issue. It's just recently, I'm talking about just the past decade, that shopping malls have started coming up in Nigeria. Where is your fashion, you know, district? Where is your shopping district in Nigeria? Where is the high street where you get all the top designers, where people flock to and buy their clothes? You get what I mean? You need to have that. That needs to be developed. And it's coming up, you know. We're beginning to have people like Grey Velvet and the rest of them sell Nigerian designers. But we need more. We need this shop, like a place like Lagos. I mean, it's ridiculous. Lagos is like 20-something million people. Or they said 15, but that's a whole country. How many malls do we have in Lagos compared to, let's say, a place like Cape Town or Dubai? You know, so when you compare, you find out that we don't have the distribution. So that's what I mean by infrastructure, you know. So we have a chain, and then the designers can feed it. So you have the manufacturing, we already have the talent. What we don't have is the infrastructure. Once that is coming, once that comes in place, The truth is that there is no ideal model. It's like asking me what is beautiful. You know, there's no ideal model. It depends on what you want to say, you know. I mean, I'm trying to talk about elegance and expensive, you know. Maybe I'll need a very slim but tall lady, you know. If I want to talk about confidence and, you know, independent, I may not be looking for a 20-year-old. I may be looking for a 30-something-year-old model. To say that, you get what I mean, you know. In fact, I may be looking for a 50-year-old model sometimes, you know, to say that. So you know, it depends. You know, there are so many factors involved. If I'm doing hip hop and we're doing, you know, that kind of thing, maybe an 18-year-old model will fit that nicely. You see, so it all depends. There is no ideal model. It depends on the story. Well, staying relevant through the years has to do with embracing that inner curiosity. You know, I mean, I'm always curious. I get bored easily. Once I take a picture and it's nice, I tell myself, okay, nice, that one is done. Let's find something else. And endlessly studying and learning new techniques, you understand? So you're just as good as your last picture. There's no time to start reminiscing on the good old days, you know. There's no time. We're too busy, you know, thinking of the next project. You get what I mean? And the next project has to be something original, different from what we've done before. Otherwise, you can find yourself in a tunnel, engaged in this endless, incestuous self-replication, you know, that happens to some people when you find a formula of the one that people like. So I don't really care so much about the one that people like. I'm interested in making a statement and seeking new ways also to tell the story. And while that happens, I think people notice that there's always something a little new, a little different in the way you express yourself. And that keeps interest. Well, the first milestone is that I should be having fun. For me, that's extremely important. For me, it's of no use to engage in any activity that does not bring joy. And that's the way I look at life. You know, you cannot run away from work. So you either enjoy what you're doing or you do what you enjoy. So I have to find a way around it. So for me, that's one goal. And the other one is, can I impress myself personally? You see, I have control over that. I don't have control over what the next person who's looking at my image is going to do. I really don't have control over that, so I don't want to worry about it, if you get what I mean. You know, you don't know. Every individual has their own bias. So if you depend on the approval of others, you wouldn't even do anything. You'd be paralyzed by fear because you don't know whether they're going to like it or not. You know, so for me, I want to do my job. My job is to make an amazing image for myself. If the people like it, beautiful. That's an added, but I've already enjoyed myself looking at the image. Oh, well, I've decided that it's extremely important that all these tricks and all these experience over the years, that I need to unbundle it and give it out, you know, to people. So I'm going to start a series of workshops, but they are going to be maybe masterclass and semi-masterclass, you know, workshops, you know, teaching people some of the techniques I've gathered over the years and getting them an in-depth deconstruction of imagery. So they are not just picking up different light settings or these, for them to understand how to tell a story, you know, with the camera and run with their own concepts. So they're not replicating you, but you've given them the formula. Well, I don't know, you know, because I'm a photographer, I hardly take pictures. I hardly take pictures with my phone, but sometimes it's me checking out a location and the phone is like the readily available camera around. But you get my family portraits in there, you know. Yeah, so what about with the kids? You know, we need to take pictures. It's always there, the phone. You know, so that's the camera that's in your pocket all the time. This is a craze that has entered, you know, our society these days. Everybody's like, you know, take a perfect selfie. Yeah, just like taking a perfect portrait, you know, follow the light. Eh? Always ask yourself where the light is. Once the light is right, then every other thing follows. But then also look at what is behind, you know, you. A lot of people are just looking at their face. You need to look at what is behind you. So I guess the perfect selfie will involve the same elements of design that are involved in taking the perfect portrait. In a photograph, a lot of times I'm looking for, there are two things, visual impact and content. So you could have a picture that really, really is beautiful and it hits your heart. So you can't forget it because it's got visual impact. But then you have another picture that doesn't have visual impact, but the storyline is so strong that it surpasses visual impact. You know, there are images that have been taken on this earth that have lasted, you know, through ages, like Marilyn Monroe trying to pull down her skirt and that wind blowing. It's not the most technically proficient image, you know, but it just happened that these guys, there were so many photographers around and they caught that moment. And those have been some of the timeless images that explain Marilyn Monroe's beauty and her, you know, seductive aura of those days. You get what I mean? And then you see those pictures that they took in Vietnam where one man was trying to blow another man's head off. Now, that may not be the most visually impactful image, but the story there is ridiculously powerful. You understand what I'm saying? Yes. So, well, Nikon, well, they gave me some of their cameras, you know, to try out. And before then, I'd been using Canon, you know. And I found out that those cameras are not bad, you know. I mean, they could do quite a bit, you know. And I've been using Nikon ever since then. You know, so it's been good.
So they were the ones that approached.
Yes.
It wasn't like after they had seen your exhibition.
Well, I mean, I've been around for a while. I think it's made. You see, hard work will beat great talent any day. Lazy, great talent. Hard work will beat a lazy, talented person any day. It's that argument about nature or nurture. You know, if you persevere and you believe, anything can be learned. I mean, I've seen short people that can jump higher than very tall people for basketball because they are determined. So even their physical appearance does not deter them. I believe in hard work, you know. That is why I say, make sure you enjoy what you do, because if you're enjoying it, then it doesn't seem to be like work. I mean, you can't tell somebody like Okocha that playing football is work. He absolutely enjoys that stuff. And he would do it anyway if he wasn't getting paid. You know, like the kids are playing football on the streets. Nobody's paying them, you know, but they turn up every weekend or whatever, you know, to sweat it out on the pitch because they enjoy it. So if you enjoy it, then you most likely put in the practice that then makes perfection. And then people look at you and they say, this guy is a genius. He must have been born like that. That is ridiculous. Do you know how many years I've been making imagery? Since I was in primary school. So do you want to call it talent or practice? I'd rather say it's practice.